The Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, I had to give up on the live stream altogether. It just, for whatever reason, we have a good connection to the internet. But it is not encoding properly and sending it out. I'm able to get to the internet just fine. Everything seems to be working. And the recording seems to be working just fine. The only thing I can think of is I have this nice little message up here that says, Windows wants to do updates. And so I'm guessing that's got things all messed up. So I guess during lunch today I'll do the updates and reboot this machine. And hopefully things will be back to normal for the evening service. Meanwhile, I am going to go ahead and just record this and I'll post it online for the folks who aren't here this morning. They'll just have to watch it after the fact. Hallelujah. So, let's go ahead, and you may be seated here this morning. We're going to go ahead, go to the Lord in prayer right now. We do have some prayer requests. Of course, we want to continue praying for little Jimmy. He had a procedure this week, and so far things are looking pretty good. So let's remember to continue to pray for him. Also, let's remember all of our usual prayer requests. Our men and women who serve, and first responders and things of that nature. If you have an unspoken request, you signify it by raising your hand here today. Hallelujah. Let's go to the Lord and ask him to touch all of our needs here today. Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for this opportunity once again to be in your presence. And Lord, we ask you right now to have your way in this tabernacle. Let your anointing fill this place, oh God. Help us, oh God, to lay aside every care and every weight. Lord God, touch every need in this place. Lord, we know that you are more than able. You are willing, oh God. And we thank you, Lord, that you are the way maker, that you are the healer, that you are the deliverer. God, that you are the all in all. And we give you all praise and glory in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated here this morning. Let's worship with Sister Della as she sings here this morning. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, the great I am, immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of Kings and mighty conqueror. And the only time, it was the only time I ever saw him run, was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son, come home again." Lifted my forgiveness in his voice. He said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" He caught me by surprise when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. And I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love to me. dusty road ahead I could see. It was the only time. It was the only time I ever saw him run. And then he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son has come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God, glory to God. Thank you, Sister Della. Hallelujah. We'll go ahead and dismiss our Sunday school to their classroom here this morning. Hallelujah, as we get ready for our Sunday school lesson. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And we are continuing our series here today that we began in the beginning a couple weeks ago. And today's lesson is about offering our best. Offering our best. It's lesson 1.3 in your devotionals. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. And I have if you're wondering what this little piece of tissue paper up here on the pulpit is all about, it'll make sense when I get to my illustration here this morning and share a little funny with you. You've heard me tell the story about taking pictures in New Hampshire. And as I was in my office this morning preparing for today, I was going through my notes and just kind of getting my thoughts in order, as I always do on Sunday mornings. And it just hit me. I thought, wow, that would be a great illustration. But I needed my... And the bad thing was, when I was leaving the house this morning, I thought, man, I want to take my camera gear with me, because it's been a while since I've taken any pictures. And I could, you know, go out in the front of the church and take some pictures. And I thought, no, I won't have time, you know, so I'm not even going to mess with it. So I'll just leave it there. So I left my camera gear sitting there. And as I was sitting there preparing this morning, getting my thoughts in order, and I thought, man, that'd make a great illustration for the at this point in the message. I really wished I'd have brought my camera gear with me, because I need it now. And I bet I could get Karen to bring it. And I thought, no, that if you get a chance to see my camera bag, it's a backpack, and it goes from about the base of my neck down to about mid hip on my back, and it has a big strap that wraps around my waist for padding and extra support, and comes down and then locks in across my chest. The bag with all of its gear in it, and it doesn't have all my camera gear, it's just got a portion of my camera gear that I use the most. That whole bag probably weighs in at 25 or 30 pounds. And so I thought, well, I could have Karen bring it to me. I thought, no, that's too much. I'm not going to ask the ladies to try to pick that thing up and haul that over here. So I'm like, I'll just do without it. And so I continued, and then I thought, man, my mind went back to that point and thought, man, that'd just be a great illustration. And then I thought, wait, I can get Buddy to do it. I'll ask Buddy to bring the laptop, my camera bag to me. So I texted Buddy and I said, hey, Buddy, will you bring me my camera bag? He said, sure, no problem. And then I texted him back and I said, well, I appreciate it. I said, do you know, I didn't want your mom to have to bring it, and I really wanted it for this illustration. He said, the mule strikes again. And because you know, we always did. Trina and I would go out in New Hampshire and we'd go taking pictures, and Buddy was our mule. He carried all the equipment, and we got to take pictures and he carried the equipment. So, but anywho, so it looks like the kids have all gone their individual little ways. So let's go ahead and jump into our lesson here for this morning. You know, we're kind of doing this series, and we're talking about the early parts of the Bible. Going back, we talked about Genesis, and we talked about last week. Thank you. I had some great feedback on last week's message. I do appreciate it. But today we're going to be talking about offering our best, and hopefully you've been going through your devotionals during the week, and as you go through each week's lesson, you know, the point of the devotionals is to try to drive home the lesson of the week and try to help reinforce it throughout the week. And so kind of the things that as you go through those, and as you think this morning about this past week, as you kind of think back on last week's lesson and then the devotionals during the week, you know, think about the things that impacted you the most. And how did those things impact your prayer life? And do you feel closer to the Lord now? And if not, why not? And those are the things we want to try to do. We want to try to drive home those questions, those thoughts, and try to get us to the point where we're contemplating these ideas and these concepts. Too often, I think church can become something we do instead of something that changes us. And I want us to be able to focus in on these things. And so the big idea of today's lesson and what you're going to focus in on this week is this concept of how we should bring our very best offering to the Lord. You know, and obviously we don't bring burnt offerings, we don't offer animals and so forth anymore, but we still do have an offering. We are to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. Amen? And so, there we go. I'm going to turn your attention to the book of Genesis chapter 4, verses 4 and 5. Genesis chapter 4, verses 4 and 5. I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation this morning. Genesis chapter 4, verses 4 and 5. Very familiar passage of Scripture. If you've done much Bible study at all, you're very familiar with this. Genesis 4, beginning in verse number 4. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. And again, we're talking about bringing our best offering to the Lord. Father, I pray that you would help us, O God. Help me, O God, to deliver this message with power and authority, love and compassion. And God, help it to find fertile soil in the hearts of hearers today. Lord, that we would be changed. made conformable to your image. And God, that we bring our very best, and we thank you for it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated here this morning. You know, there are times in life as a young person that you find yourself in trouble. I've told this story before, but it bears repeating. When I was a very young wee lad, one day, mom and dad, back in the day, I don't know if they still do this or anymore or not, probably not, because, you know, it number one, it's probably sexist, and number two, they probably don't do this because, you know, hey, we can't, you know, let children aspire to something great. And number three, probably because there's probably something in these toys that would cause some kind of harm, you know. But back in the day, they used to have these little plastic, look like doctor bags. And inside was, you know, like little stethoscopes and little toys that you could purchase. And one was a doctor bag and one was a nurse bag. And you could pretend to be a doctor or a nurse. And so you had these little toys. And mom and dad bought me one of these little doctor bags as a wee little kid. And I was, of course, as a young little 5-6-year-old boy, of course, you got to run around. You got to give everybody checkups. You know, you got your new doctor bag. Obviously, it's time for everybody's annual physical.
Yes.
And so I'm running around the house doing annual physicals. And mom and dad decided to hop on the motorcycle and go off somewhere before they got their physical, which that was not a good thing because they needed their physical before they got on that motorcycle. I'm just letting you know right here, right now. And so I took out the door after them running down the street to give them their physicals. And, of course, they were on the motorcycle, so they didn't hear or see me, and off they went. And my grandma is in a panic, and she goes chasing after me, but she's barefoot. So she goes running after me, as you can imagine, a little 5-year-old, and grandma chasing after the little 5-year-old barefooted as she runs hopping through the yard trying to catch the little 5-year-old as he runs down the street. And she ends up in a sticker patch in one of the neighbor's yards, which then that, of course, just made things even worse. So by the time grandma got to me, grandma was not real thrilled, to say the least. And I got my backside smacked every step from wherever it was, a couple houses down or whatever, all the way back to grandma's house. And when mom and dad got home, dad wanted to do it again because he didn't get the joy of being in on that whole process. And so, you know, it was important that, you know, he got in on that. And grandma said, no, I think he's had enough. But it reminds me of the story of the young boy who one day he's out in the shop with his uncle, and the two of them were very close. And little Johnny, he's sitting there as his uncle is working, and his uncle gets on to him. And for little Johnny, it seemed like his uncle was overreacting. You know, his favorite uncle is getting on to him for something that just seems so minor and so not worthy of such a vicious attack. And why was his favorite uncle so upset with him? Well, if you would have been there that day, you would have found out that his uncle was doing some welding. And as he was welding, little Johnny was watching the arc. But he didn't have any eye protection on. And so his uncle got on to him about not watching the arc while not wearing eye protection. And the boy didn't realize that what he was doing could lead to permanent eye damage. And the uncle was only looking out for the interests of his favorite nephew. So in reality, the uncle getting on to the young boy was really an act of kindness. Amen? In our world today, people say you're judgmental, you're hateful, because you try to emphasize the right way to live. But the Bible is very clear that we should not call evil good and good evil. Yet that seems to be the exact opposite of what our world is bent on doing today. And if we're not careful, we can mistake kindness for hate and hate for kindness. For example, which of these sayings that I'm going to mention here this morning is hateful or cruel, and which of these are kind and compassionate? Don't stick things into electric sockets. Don't play in traffic. Not all paths lead to heaven. Now, all of these are equated with negative concepts, and you're being very hateful and so forth. But then you turn around and do whatever you want as long as it feels good. God's not interested in how you act. Sex outside of marriage is okay if you love the other person. All of these are seen as very loving and caring statements, but yet they aren't. You see, when you take a child and you leave a child to their own judgments and interests, they will often end up in trouble. Amen?
Amen.
This is why God's word is so important to us. God expects us to live right. And when we do, it leads to us living a more abundant life, just like He promised we would. When God is allowed to teach us how to give our very best, we end up being the ones who benefit from it. Because it allows Him, in turn, to give His very best. Think about that for a minute this morning. When we allow God to direct our lives, guide us, help us to give our very best, in turn, He's able to bless us with His very best. Now, this concept leads us to a bit of a conundrum. It leads to the battle of good and evil. You see, there is a war going on. And God, through His word, always tells us exactly what He expects of us. Because of His love for us, He has communicated His will to us through His word. Amen? And His will is communicated not only through His commandments, but also through His messages of hope and His promises that He has embedded in His word. He has made it clear that His blessings and promises directly correlate to our obedience. It's much like the parent who wants to give good things to their children, but if the child is misbehaving, you cannot give them good gifts, because you're rewarding bad behavior. This is a problem that our world has today. Why we have rampant crime and the nonsense we have going on today, because we've raised a bunch of children that think just because you participate, you get a trophy. God told Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 through 19, "Now listen. Today I'm giving you a choice between life and death, between prosperity and disaster. For I have commanded you this day to love the Lord your God and to keep His commands, decrees, and regulations by walking in His ways. If you do this, You will live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you and the land that you are about to enter and occupy. But if your heart turns away and you refuse to listen, and if you are drawn away to serve and worship other gods, then I warn you, now that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live long, or not live a long good life in the land you are crossing the Jordan to occupy. Today I have given you the choice between life and death, between blessings and curses. Now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make. Oh, that you would choose life so that you and your descendants might live. This, to me, is the heart of a loving and caring parent. Look, I am not going to dictate to you how you should live, but I am setting before you a choice. You can choose how you want to live. I pray that you choose life. I pray that you choose the blessings. I pray that you choose the good things that I have for you. Because if you don't, there is pain in your future and suffering and heartache that you can't even imagine. Even though God tells us right from wrong, He still gives us the choice to obey or not. This is what we call our free will. It ensures that our relationship to Him is strictly voluntary. He does not want you to be a mindless lemming. He wants you to make a conscious decision to love Him. He wants you to make that decision on your own. Now, this does involve risk on His part. It really does. But love cannot exist without the risk of pain and betrayal. Love involves risk. You and I can make the choice. We can make the choice of selfishness or selflessness. We can make the choice between unrighteousness and righteousness. We can make the choice between hell and heaven. It's our choice. And the Bible has a lot of examples for us of people who made the wrong choice. People like Balaam, Lot's wife, King Saul, Samson, the strongest man to ever live, Judas, who walked and talked with Him on this earth. All are examples of those who turned down the wrong path. And there is judgment for everyone who refuses to choose life over death. But it's still your choice. And so thus we, as human beings, continue to struggle with this concept of good versus evil. We continually make choices in our life. Sometimes good choices, sometimes bad choices. Yep. I'm reminded a lot of times, I still use this saying. Brother Rader was famous for this saying. And he'd say, I should have had my head examined. And I still use, from time to time, I'll look back on a choice that I made and go, I should have had my head examined. We all make choices. Life is about the choices we make, the decisions we make in life. And despite the fact that you and I, sitting under the sound of my voice, have chosen to be born again, that's not the end of the choice. Because every day we choose to either continue down the path of life or get off of it. Romans 8 and 7 tells us that we're in a war. Can you imagine? You were sold a bill of goods, weren't you? You weren't told you were signing up for war. But that's what you were doing. The reason you weren't told is because you were already an enemy. You just came over to the other side.
Yeah.
You just didn't even realize you were in a war. You were being forced to fight and didn't know it.
Amen.
Now you have the choice. Do you want to fight and resist? Or do you just want to go with the flow? And since we are in a war, you can look at your Christian life one of two ways. You can look at the Christian life as being very hard. It's so hard to live for God. I have to fight my flesh. I have to die out to myself. I don't get to do this. I don't get to do that. And you can whine and complain, and you can be a snowflake that melts under the slightest heat. Or you can look at this Christian life as a privilege. I get to live as His ambassador in this world. I get to live as His example to this untoward generation. I get to make choices that not only impact my life, but impact the lives of other people and impact all of eternity. I get to choose that. I get that privilege. You see, it's not just about judgment. Our judgment is not enough. We need His Word. We need His Spirit to guide us. Because even when you and I want to do our best, and I don't need to see any hands, but you know what I'm talking about. Even when we want to do our best, we find ourselves totally frustrated and confused and undone. Even the great apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 7, verses 17 through 23, "So I am not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I am not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong." You ever felt like Paul? You say, I try to do right, but it seems like every time I open my mouth, something bad comes out, or I say something the wrong way, or something like that. Verse 22, "I love God's law with my whole heart, but there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me." You see, deep down inside, we really do want to do good. We really do want to do right. We want to please God. We want to be on the path of life and righteousness and good. But our flesh, our carnal nature, our desires war against the inner man. It desires rebellion. It desires things that are not good for us. So our only hope in winning this war, you ready for it? I'm about to give you the best advice you're ever going to get. When it comes to battle, when it comes to warfare, when it comes to defeating your enemy, the only way you're going to win is to surrender. Now, don't surrender to him. Don't surrender to your enemy. Don't surrender to your will. Don't surrender to all. Surrender to God.
Yes.
Surrender to His Spirit. You see, because ultimately we win when we finally give up and say, "God, it's all yours. I'm tired of doing it my way. I'm tired of trying to make this thing work. I'm tired of trying and failing. I surrender to you. When we do, we find there is victory. We find there is hope. We find we can overcome. See, ultimately, this story of Cain and Abel is a story of sibling rivalry. And I love the story of Cain and Abel. It's a story that goes well beyond just a usual story of siblings fighting among themselves. And it gives us a look, if you will, into the battle of the flesh versus the spirit. It represents for us the battle between the carnal man and the spirit man. See, both of these boys were raised by the same set of parents. And they were not raised in a broken home, so they had the same teaching. Isn't it interesting how I've always been amazed how you can raise kids, four kids, all the same, and each one of them turns out different. None of my kids are the same. Even the twins aren't the same. But it's because each of us is a unique individual. And Cain and Abel are no different. Two men, raised in their parents' home, same teaching, same background, everything. And here we are. You say, how do you know they knew how to do right? Because when you look at the story of Cain and Abel, it says, when the time came to bring sacrifices, they brought their sacrifices. How did they know, number one, that there was a time to bring a sacrifice if mom and daddy didn't teach them that? Number two, how did they know if mom and daddy taught them to bring a sacrifice? I guarantee you mom and daddy taught them the right way to bring a sacrifice. So it's clear that they understood that there was a sacrifice required. But one brought what he had on hand, while the other brought the blood that his parents told him was required. Now, you've heard me say this countless times. Cain could have gone to his brother and said, hey, I need a sheep for the sacrifice today. Can I give you some crops and we make a trade for a sheep? No harm, no foul. But why didn't he? Why didn't Cain make the effort? Well, I think it's indicative of the world we live in today. You see, maybe he argued, well, this is the best crops that I have right here. This is my very best crops that I'm bringing to the Lord. But if that's your argument, you have to go back and look at the text because it says he brought some of his crops. It doesn't necessarily say that he brought the best that he had. Now, he may have. We don't know. But another thing that's very common in our world today is this concept. Well, he brought an offering that cost him something. You know, it cost him something to bring that offering, right? We go back, we think about the story of David, right? And the plague sweeping through the land, and he goes to buy the threshing floor to Verona. And when he gets there, he says, no, king, I'll just give it to you. And David says, no. I'm not going to offer something to God that didn't cost me something. So clearly Cain is offering something that cost him something. So this unkind, unfeeling God should have just accepted what he brought. But here's the crux of the matter. What Cain brought that day was not what God expected Cain to bring. Go back to our illustration earlier about the young boy working with his uncle in the garage. He wasn't expecting his uncle to get on to him. But it was because he had done wrong. And it wasn't that he had done something wrong to his uncle. It was that he had done something wrong to himself. Something that would cause him harm later on in life. Abel, on the other hand, not only brought the fruit of his labor, like Cain did, but he did what mom and dad had taught him to do. He followed God's plan and brought a lamb for the sacrifice. And he sacrificed blood for sin. See, you look in the Bible and you'll find out there are such things as grain offerings. There are offerings of crops, of the first fruits of your crops and your labors. But that's not an offering for sin. An offering for sin requires blood, because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Now, if you're on the outside of this story looking in, if you're with CNN, MSNBC, or any of the other tabloid news journalism, you'd look at this and say, this was two religious people worshiping God as their faith dictated. But that's not how God looks at it. God measures it not on the same scale that you and I measure it on. God measures it based on His Word. And so Cain's offering ultimately was rejected. Now Cain got to listen into the fake news. Well, he should have accepted your offering because you brought an offering too that cost you something. And he begins listening to the fake news. And when he does, he decides that God has been unfair. You and I can do things in our life that seem like we're worshiping God and wonder why God doesn't bless it. It's because we aren't following God's word. We're not doing it His way. You and I have to realize God does not allow us to shape His truth based on our perceptions. I'm going to say that again, because I want to make sure you get this. God does not allow you to shape His truth based on our perceptions. Now here's my illustration. And it's going to be hard for you folks in the audience this morning to really see this illustration. So you can go online and watch it, because it's going to make a lot more sense. I have this little bitty flashlight. God's the God of light, right? You with me? So when I turn on this itty bitty little flashlight, I have a nice little light coming out. But when I aim this directly in the lens of this camera, it goes entirely white. And the folks watching this see nothing but a big, bright, white bulb in their face. Even though this is just a tiny speck of light. Now, that's the way God is. You see, just a little tiny bit of God changes everything we see, how we perceive things. But as a photographer, I have here in my hand what's called a neural density filter. It's actually called a 10-stop neural density filter. I'm not going to go through the details of why that is. It's a very, very black piece of glass that you put in front of your lens. And you say, well, that doesn't make any sense. Why would you put a black filter in front of your lens? Well, I'm not going to go into the boring details, but it can change the way your pictures look, the way things look. This is a filter. Filters are designed to change your perception. So when I put God's blinding light in front of you, You don't see things the same way that you used to see. So our tendency is to want to put a filter in front of God's light. Now, for those of you online, you'll notice you now can see my hand. You can see the filter. You can see a little bit of the background. But the light isn't blinding anymore, because there's a filter in front of it. What's my point? My point is simply this. When you begin trying to filter God's truth by your perceptions, it changes things. Amen. It's no longer God's truth. It's a filtered view of it. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22 and 23. You see, Cain had this problem. He had placed a filter up and said, this is the way I perceive things, and God has to accept it that way. And Saul had that same problem. Samuel replies, what is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifices, or your obedience to his voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission better than offering the fat of rams. Rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft, and stubbornness as bad as worshiping idols. So because you have rejected the command of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. What's the difference between Cain and Saul? Cain brought the first, brought his fruits of his ground. He didn't bring an animal. Saul brought an animal and offered an animal. But the prophet tells him, you have done wrong. Wait, no, Samuel, I've done right. Cain did wrong. But Samuel says, no, Saul, you've put a filter up. You have refused to obey the Lord. And though you worshiped him the way he prescribed, you're out of obedience. You're not following the plan. You're doing it your way. You see, our worship, even if done right, can be wrong if it's not done from the heart and done according to God's word. Obedience is the best way we can live. As Christians, you and I respond to God's word. And we cannot expect him to change based on our point of view. Just because we put the filter up, we can't expect him to change how the truth is laid out before us. Our filters don't matter. This is because everything I'm talking about this morning is dealing with the concept of lordship and submission. He is Lord, and we submit. It's more than just the sacrifice. Whether it's the fruit, whether it's the lamb, whether it's the blood, it doesn't. That's not the important thing. It's the obedience. It's the submission more than the sacrifice itself. It's not about the processes and the procedures and dotting all the I's and crossing all the T's. It's about, are we doing it how we have been instructed to do it? You see, God expects our very best. That's all he's looking for, is our very best. Now, many of us have seen missionaries, met missionaries, talked to missionaries. We had lots of missionaries come through this church. And I'm sure you've probably thought, as most of us have, wow, they make such great sacrifices. I mean, you think about it. They leave their family and their country. They leave the first world most often and go to third world. I mean, the thing that always amazes me is when the ladies start talking about Mother's Memorial, which provides them with laundry equipment.
Right.
You and I, we take that for granted.
Right.
You know, we have a washer and a dryer. If you don't, you usually have a laundromat not too far down the street. It's just the way it is. And these ladies go to these countries where they, if they don't have a washer and dryer, they're going to have to go out and beat their laundry on a rock. Yeehaw. You know? And so we look at that and we go, wow, they sacrifice so much. They endure so many hardships, and sometimes they'll even suffer torture. I don't know how many times I've read stories or talked to missionaries where they've had family members killed. And they come back to the States and bury their loved ones and go back out to that mission field right where their loved one died. And you sit there and think, wow, what an amazing hero or heroine. What a great person of the faith. How wonderful they are, you know. But when they come on deputation, these missionaries don't often emphasize the dangers that they face. They don't emphasize so much as they do the victories that God gives them. They don't talk about their life as being a sacrifice as much as they talk about the blessings that God has given them. I have a short video that I want to share. It's about a missionary. But before I go into this, I want to make sure I explain something. At the very beginning, it's kind of quiet. You don't get to hear. But basically, the person is asking the question of this missionary. He says, look, you know, what do you say about people who look at you and talk about the sacrifices you made and how great of a hero you are? And he goes off and he talks about this. So I want to go ahead and show this video here to you this morning and let you see it.
Tell me a little bit how you feel or what you think when somebody asks you about all the sacrifices you had to make as a missionary, or when they call you a hero being a missionary.
Well, whenever I hear someone mention the type of sacrifices I've made or mention that I'm a hero, my typical response is, who? Me? I don't even realize that they're talking about me. My wife and I were missionaries for almost 30 years in Africa. Our children were taken to the mission field when they were about 7 weeks old. I don't remember a time that I ever thought that I was sacrificing. It was an honor. It was the least that I could do to seek first God's kingdom. As far as a hero, I never really thought of myself as a hero. I thought of myself as a servant, a shepherd, a steward, but never a hero. And the scripture is really plain when it says that you should present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is but your reasonable service. So I don't really think in terms of sacrifice. I think more in terms of service to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the God of Gods. There's an old Nigerian chorus that they used to sing, Jesus surrendered his life for me. So Jesus sacrificed his life for me. What have I done for him? So to sacrifice or to serve, it's always a pleasure and an honor to be part of God's kingdom.
Amen. Hallelujah. The main crux of that video, what I hope you get from it anyway, is that sacrifice is good. Because sacrifice, really in and of itself, is not a sacrifice. Sacrifice is but a token that we give to show how great and wonderful God really is. When you give, yes, it costs you something. But what you get in return is so much greater than what you've given. Even if you were to give your entire life, your existence on the face of this earth, He literally did the same thing for you already. So ultimately, church, I will give my very best. And I don't expect a reward. Because what I give is not a sacrifice. Though, for those on the outside, it may appear that it is. But rather, it's just the very least that I can do.
Amen.
Stand with me here this morning. Give you some hope. There's a story about a grocer who was able to go out and buy 100 bushels of apples. But because they were fresh apples, he needed to move them out very quickly. And unfortunately, normally he would have set up a sidewalk display and had a big sale. But the city had recently passed an ordinance where he was no longer allowed to have product out on the sidewalk. So he was just going to put the displays up inside the building. Unfortunately, he had to go out of town on a business trip. So he put his store manager in charge of it and said, "Look, I want you to set out this display, but just set out a couple bushels at a time. That way it drives up demand. And keep the rest of them in the back. And as it dwindles, then you bring out the fresh apples. And let's try to get rid of these apples this weekend." And so the owner of the store goes off on his trip, leaves the manager in charge. Now the manager knew that he had a big job to do. He needed to get rid of these apples this weekend before they went bad and get them sold. And he knew that the sidewalk sales always went well. And not only did they sell any of the product on the sidewalk, but it also brought people into the store. And so he decided that he would slash the prices of the apple, and he'd put up a big display out in front of the store on the sidewalk, enticing people to come in and buy the apples and more product. And he did very well the first day, sold several bushels of the apples. Things went very well, and they had good business. And so he was fully expecting by day two of the weekend, he'd be able to sell everything else. But the next morning when he got there to get things set up, he noticed a envelope hanging on the door of the store. When he opened it, it was a citation from the city and a $1,000 fine for having set up the sidewalk display. My question to you is simply this morning. Where did the manager go wrong? He sold the apples. He got rid of the apples just like the owner wanted him to. Well, the problem is, the manager chose to do it his way instead of the owner's way. And he didn't have all the details that the boss had. He didn't have all the information. He was not operating with all the information he needed. You say, "Pastor, what's this got to do with me?" Jesus came to seek and to save those that are lost. That's His plan. His ways are above our ways. His plans above our plans. You and I cannot honor God properly by being a hero, by being a knight in shining armor, by doing some great thing. He cannot bless us unless we follow His plan. He doesn't expect you to know all the details. He doesn't expect you to be the knight in shining armor. He doesn't even want you to be the Savior of the world. He's already done that. He just wants you to follow the plan. Father, I thank you today for your word. I pray, Lord, that you would help us, oh God, to understand what it means to offer our very best. You're not looking for greatness. You're just looking for someone willing to do the job and get it done. Lord, I pray right now, lead and guide and direct us. Help us, oh Lord, to offer our very best to you. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship the Lord here this morning.
With all my breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me.
Father, I thank you today for your word. I thank you, God, for who you are. Lord, go with us as we depart from this place, Lord, and bring us safely back at the appointed hour, we pray, in Jesus' precious name, amen. God bless you. Go with the Lord in Jesus' name.